The first film in Denis Villeneuve's adaptation of the sci-fi epic Dune has been met with much praise for the actors' performances and its cinematography. However, many viewers, Dune fans included, have lingering questions regarding this new interpretation of Frank Herbert's acclaimed novel. Recently, the director sat down with Empire magazine for an interview to discuss the film and the reasoning behind some of his major creative decisions. While he doesn't get too heavy with spoilers, especially when answering questions that involve the second installment, the details he does include are revealing. In this video, I'd like to break down this interview and discuss what stood out to me the most, and what this tells us about the upcoming sequel. The interview begins with a discussion regarding where Dune Part 1 ends. When asked if Villeneuve always knew where he would end it, the filmmaker said, quote, "My first intuition was to break there, and then we tried also to break it a bit later. Because in the book, there's a natural moment. There's like a 2-year time gap or something like that. But it didn't work out because it really felt like at the very end of 2.5 hours, you were suddenly starting a new story, which is the one of Paul and Jessica being introduced to Fremen culture and being accepted by the Fremen. It was feeling like the beginning of a new chapter, which felt very heavy at the end. I'm 100% positively convinced that we stuck at the right moment, where we finally feel that Paul has gone from being a boy to an adult and having all this arc of this first part completed." The ending of Dune Part 1 has been a hot topic among both fans and general audiences. It certainly was a surprise for many, as Villeneuve confirmed in this interview that at one point the ending was intended to be at the start of the 2-year time jump. This was also indicated in an early version of the script and by those involved in the production, who pointed to the natural endpoint within the novel itself. I understand Villeneuve's creative choice and agree with his reasoning. My only criticism with the ending was that the climax of the film, encountering the Sandworm, the Fremen, and the subsequent fight between Paul and Jaymes, did feel rushed and threw the pacing off a bit for me. Also, as I've stated before in my review of the film, I was missing the part where Paul chose his Fremen name, Moadib, the name of the desert mouse on Arrakis, which was seen multiple times throughout the film. I feel that would have helped to give Part 1 more of a conclusive feel, with the added sense that the story was far from over. Those are just my thoughts. However, I must admit that I am also a bit concerned about how this decision will affect Part 2, specifically how the lengthy passage of time will be conveyed, or even if it will be presented in the film at all. The conversation then focused on where the filmmaker started with his adaptation, and whether it was on Paul Atreides as a character. Villeneuve says, quote, "Yes, the book is about Paul Atreides, but there are several characters, and we are in the book embracing several points of view. My dream was to stay very focused only on Paul, but to sometimes have a glimpse on other characters in order to understand the story. But mainly, we stay with Paul and we focus more specifically on him and his relationship with his mother, Lady Jessica. That for me was at the very heart of the story, and it allowed me also to bring more light on the Bene Gesserit sisters and their movement, and on one of my favorite characters of the book, Lady Jessica." I find his answer interesting, as I think his approach to the story of Dune is important to keep in mind as production on the sequel gets underway. There has been much speculation surrounding some of Villeneuve's past comments regarding the greater role that Zendaya's Chani will have in Part 2, with some reaching the conclusion that the next installment will focus mainly on Chani, with Paul having a diminished role. But in light of these remarks, I think it's important to consider that this 2-part adaptation is telling the story of Dune, and these are 2 pieces of one story. As the director stated, this book is about Paul Atreides, yet like he noted here, there are several characters that will have different points of view to add. I believe the director will handle the large ensemble cast of characters for Part 2 in a similar manner to his first installment, so that even though other characters such as Chani will be featured prominently, this will not diminish Paul's role in the story of Dune. Speaking about Part 2 and the large cast of characters, Villeneuve was asked about one character in particular that was notably absent in the first film, the Harkonnen heir, Fade Rotha. Since this antagonist was never cast for Part 1, it was apparent that Villeneuve decided to save his introduction for Part 2. The director commented on his reasoning for this, stating, quote, That's a choice that I personally brought on. There was enough characters that were introduced in this first part, and it will be more elegant to keep Fade for part 2. It will be definitely a very, very important character in the second part. This comment by Villeneuve serves to confirm what was previously stated by Roger Yuan, the fight coordinator for Dune, in an interview back in March of 2021 with KungFuKingdom.com. The veteran fight coordinator and martial artist also plays an Atreides soldier in the film called Lieutenant Landville. In regards to the connection his character has with Fade Rotha in part 2, Roger said, quote, "Denis wanted me to play a part in the film because if the first one does well, which we hope it will, and we complete the book, then I'll come back as a character called Lieutenant Landville. I have a battle to the death with Fade Rotha, which is in the book." Roger's character was seen briefly in Dune Part 1, and I do hope this is still the plan moving forward for his character and his epic confrontation with Fade Rotha. If you'd like to learn more about this interview with Roger Yuan and his work developing the different fighting styles of Dune, please check out my video on the subject as well as the original KungFuKingdom.com interview. I'll leave the links in the description below. Continuing in the Empire interview, the discussion turned to the Spacing Guild representatives and their massive Highliner ships. I found this topic warranted its own video, as there was lots of information to unpack in his comments. For a full breakdown of the Spacing Guild and their Highliner ships, and how these elements were interpreted in Villeneuve's adaptation, please check out my video on how space travel works in Villeneuve's Dune. I'll also leave a link in the description for that. To briefly summarize Villeneuve's comments, he confirmed that the Spacing Guild members among the Imperial delegation arriving on Caladan were Guild representatives, not navigators. And though we see the massive Guild ships that appear to fold space and act as a sort of stargate, we don't see how this process works or how the navigators are involved, as they are necessary to find safe paths between the stars. The director stated that he tried to keep space traveling as mysterious as possible for now, and confirmed that it will be explained in more detail in Part 2. The upcoming sequel is shaping up to be an incredibly dynamic, action-packed installment. There are so many exciting moments to come, but there are a lot of elements to flesh out that the first film left mysterious or underdeveloped. The Harkonnens weren't featured all that much in Part 1, and now we have a new antagonist to add to the mix in Fade Rotha. Then there's also the Emperor and the Spacing Guild that can be fleshed out as well. While watching Dune Part 1, at times I wondered if Villeneuve was holding back in this film, trying not to include too many world-building details or too much exposition for fear of alienating general audiences. With no guarantee at the time regarding whether or not a sequel would be greenlit, I don't blame him for his conservative approach. Now it seems the director will have more creative freedom for Part 2, and Villeneuve is barely able to contain his excitement for the upcoming sequel. Earlier in the interview, the director stated, "Part 2 will be such a cinematic treat. Making Part 1 for me was just to set the table, you know, and to explain the cultures in the background of all the different planets and civilizations. And then to have that chance, now that everything is set, Part 2 will be just an amazing playground. It will be so fun to do." I'm definitely excited to learn more about Villeneuve's approach to this highly anticipated conclusion to this epic story. But I'm curious to know what you think. How do you think the filmmaker's creative decisions for Part 1 will impact the sequel? How do you think the 2-year time jump in the book should be handled? Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. I hope you enjoyed this video. Leave a like if you did, and be sure to subscribe for more Dune and other sci-fi and fantasy news and lore. Thank you all so much for your support, and as always, have a very nerdy day.